it for? So
no, it came from where, the funding?
The Delhi University Innovations Project funding. And so
so that was how much and in which year?
This was 2015. Hmm. We received the funding from August is when we had applied for it. So there are call for applications that are circulated, and then any Delhi University college can.
How much was that?
This was 3.5 lakhs.
That's all you had?
That's all we had. And considering that we only had that much, we also had to figure out how to maximize the kind of work that we wanted to do.
And this money was given to you for 1 year?
For 1 year, yes. To the students. They are paid a stipend out of this money.
And we
these
also had
were
to...
your workers in the project?
No, these students were our research assistants. The workers in the project were identified in the Jhuggi Jhopri clusters, the women. So we had to go out and work with them, help them to develop the products, do the skill training, and then market those products. So we are really not talking of a huge amount of funding.
Are you getting any interest from the corporate sector under the
new CSR? We haven't yet approached it. We are not yet sure what kind of model we are looking at, because CSR initiatives have their own mandates. And I believe...
you develop a project, go to a corporate, what is their own mandate? There's no mandate.
This is a project
which is very successful. You have actually created something out of nothing. Any corporate would be happy to, as he talks about scalability. Yeah. This is something that needs to be scaled up. See, right now what you've done is 3.5 lakh, which is a pittance.
It is.
The current 2% CSR legislation attracts money in these areas in crores. There are 20,000 crores annually is what CSR is promoting in the country. And today, corporates are desperately looking for projects such as yours.
So if we had a sort of interest from a CSR initiative. It hasn't worked out yet. At the moment, the women want to go on their own in terms of creating a SHG. So we are in talks with two other NGOs who work in other areas. And I think they would prefer to work on this model rather than be part of a CSR initiative. We are formally out of it. At the moment, we are only informally associating with the group.
So you, what kind of an organization are you?
We are an undergraduate college under Delhi University.
Okay. So you typically would not attract any funding as
no,
an organization?
No, we are not even allowed to do so unless the university mandates it.
So you will have to partner with
yes,
NGOs and
yes,
get them to
yes,
do that.
Yes, yes,
yes. That's why I was interested to know how you are registered and how you are registered.
No, we are not registered at the moment. Okay. And so we'll really have to look at a particular model that works with this particular
group. But
you've
created something so wonderful, you know, you mustn't stop here.
No, we don't want to. We will like to. That's why I said please visit,
you know, at many locations.
Yeah, the Facebook page and like it. And hopefully order some stuff from us.
Okay, good. Any other questions? Yeah. Please have a seat.
Thank you, Professor Rakesh Gupta. It was a very good case study which actually throws a lot of light on growing social inequality and blends a lot many topics of innovation, sustainability and social responsibility to create social value. Now I open the floor for question and answer if we have any from the two presenters.
Ms. Chatterjee, I think
good evening.
Your project was extremely, I think what you also achieved was making good financial model out of it, meaning if you leave it to them, they could earn their own money, isn't it?
Sorry, couldn't get the question.
Meaning after your training was completed.
Is it to Smith, no. Professor Smitha, yeah.
Yeah, yeah, yes.
Both of you, as a matter of fact, yeah. So it was a self-sustaining model in the long term, which means after the project that you completed, those women were able to do it themselves and earn money out of it. Am I right?
No.
So they constantly need help, monetary support.
At the moment, we are still supporting them. We have just wrapped up the project in November.
Yeah.
2016.
Correct.
And the self-help group that we thought we would be able to set up has not yet worked out because we are short in numbers. There are just 10 at the moment.
Yeah.
And yeah, we need 15. So now some other people from the community have shown an interest. So we are hoping that given another 2-3 months, we will be able to do that. And then our idea, as I was telling Professor Chatterjee, is to actually converge with two other NGOs who are working in similar conditions. One is in Trilokpuri and one is in Mandavali. And then they are ready to collaborate. So as soon as that collaboration works out with this particular cluster of SHG, then we exit out of it.
So at that point of time, will it become a self-sustaining
yes,
model?
Yes, we are hoping because if they are hoping, able to set up an SHG, then the financing bit is taken care of.
Yeah.
And those other two NGOs are also working with marginalized urban women, migrant populations in Trilokpuri and Mandavali. So we wanted, you cannot compete with a Fab India model or an Anokhi model, because we are not talking of women who are trained artisans, who are far removed from their traditional moorings and background, who have been married off at a very young age, have had very difficult lives. And when we started working with them in terms of skill training, the narrative was, hame kuch nahi aata hai. From there, we have come to a state where they are dictating colors, material, and the stuff that they wanted to do. So I think it has been a journey forward for them, but yes, we are aware of the tremendous responsibility that we have now, that if we have come this far, then we need to go the next mile. So we are trying to work it out, but at the moment, in tandem with the women entrepreneurs, they're not very confident of a CSR initiative. They are at the moment used to dealing with us, but they're very keen on working as a self-help group. So that's our target for the moment. We shall see. And hopefully it will work out.
And now the project for the Goonj.
Yeah.
Here I find that yours is basically based on donations, 50% of it. And then you're selling some products, etc. And you're trying to make it, balance your funds. Now, why don't you look at a possibility in which you said that the clothes that you get from the urban areas, they're oversized, most of them. You train these rural guys up into refurbishing the dresses into their right size, okay? Have nice goon stores in the rural areas and make money out of them. So then they will stop receiving the funding from you. It can be a self-sustaining model.
Look, two ways to answer this.
First,
it is a self-sustainable model already. So it is not that it is not.
But that is coming through donations.
No, I am coming to that.
Yeah.
The second issue is, I think it to a large extent also boils down to the philosophy of the founder also. I think an entrepreneurial venture, whether we like it or not, I think he, the founder in this case, and I think probably we also agree, he says, I don't want to charge anything for the clothes.
For the clothes?
Yeah. So I think, and if you start looking at it in the fitness of things, donations, he is also not going out and seeking. Like one of the examples was, he said, in 1 year, we got an anonymous donation of close to 22 crores.
For the Uttarakhand clothes?
Yeah. So the question is, the philosophy of the founders come in a big way. He says, those who have owes it to society. So he doesn't want to do away with donations.
So how does the business model work? If you're not selling your clothes.
They are selling. They are selling the clothes not in that way, but the clothes or the parts of the clothes which has no value. Then they create something out of it. That they sell.
They have done empowerment of women in the villages also through the making of sutis.
Why don't you come here?
I can share it, I think I'm audible, right? One of the advantages of being a person. Yeah, that works.
They have done empowerment of women in the villages by, you know, a lot of clothes have, say, drawstrings of pajamas and all that. So using all that waste material, they have taught rural women, and they also train a lot of women from the slums. They are the seamstresses. If you watch their operations, which we did for days on end, so women come from the urban slums and work as seamstresses. The same thing happens in the to rural women. They teach them to make these rajais, and they are making money out of them. So, and the huge quantities of such kind of rajais or sujinis have been sold. So it's not as if there is no self-help or empowerment. But they also believe in a parallel economy which is called labor. They are saying it's not free. They have already paid through one currency. They are making a school. They are building a bridge. They are making roads. And they are lobbying to the government when the government sees this kind of work funding does come for infrastructure. So they are giving labor. Since when is labor not a currency? So is money only the currency? Labor is also a currency. They are paying through labor. All this work is not free, it's free, they are entitled to it. Even for disaster relief, for the first 2 months, they give disaster packs. But after that, the disaster hit people have to, they start rehabilitating by involving them in rescuing each other. So they have to rebuild. So when press and media departs, and all the furrow dies down, they are on their own, they have to rebuild their lives once again through Cloth for Work. You know?
Just to add on. I think we seem to be compartmentalizing the same approach by suggesting, no, this is the right business model to follow. I think one of the interesting insights of this story or the case is they have continued to follow a different business model and they say it is working. The point, when we raise this question even to the founder, he said that if I have been able to do it successfully for 20 years, I am pretty confident that I am going to do it even for foreseeable future. So he doesn't want to cut on the donations and try to find out money somewhere else. I think that's a point which many of us, coming from a business modeling perspective, try to put across. Whereas his approach is a totally different one. And it is working. We've got to accept this.
1990 20
years.
Yeah.
Can I add something to it? I'm one of the donors to Goonj, and I think what I liked in your presentation was this bit about mindsets. And you know, whenever my friends and I do a donation to Goonj, and if we're donating clothes, we ensure that the clothes are dry cleaned before they're sent or before one of us delivers it to it, including children's toys. So soft toys, many parents donate them, or they donate books, but the idea is that hame zarurat nahi hai, ghar mein jagah nahi hai. The point is that Goonj doesn't believe in that philosophy. You only donate things that you will need and you appreciate, not things that you want to throw away. So I think that's a big innovation in terms of also working with people who want to donate, but donate it the right way. I think that's what is a very, very huge mindset change, even within individual give and take that we need to do as a society.
Look, if I'm not taking too much time, if I add half a minute, the important idea I think Goonj is pursuing is the founder's approach or the general approach of the organization is if you spend too much effort in terms of building business models, somewhere you start looking as a replica of a commercial organization, leading to a loss of credibility. And that loss of credibility also leads to a loss of revenue, whereas the approach taken by this organization is fundamentally different. Let's build credibility. And once a credibility is built, the other things will follow. In fact, the last thing when we checked with him, he is thinking about is, let all those who donate clothes also donate a rupee or two on every cloth they donate. The idea is, you take responsibility also now that you have given us the cloth, but it also reaches the needy.
Okay, so what we find here are actually two different, very different models, both extremely interesting. And that is, I think, what the jury found to be so intriguing about both of these projects. There were innovative in themselves, very different from what we normally see societies and trusts doing. And our very eminent jury member here, covers things out. We now request him to tell us a little bit about how he went about his task and how he came to the conclusion about the two tests.
Respected Dr. Bhaskar Chatterjee, and of course the award winners Smita ji and Rakesh ji and their team, and Ms. Dr. Acharya, distinguished participants, ladies and gentlemen. Let me begin by saying good evening to each one of you, and also let me say that it was truly a privilege to be associated with this initiative. I must compliment, first of all, ILM for being one of the pioneering institute to follow the UN Global Compact program, and especially the principle of responsible business. There are only a few institutions in India that have imbibed and followed, and they have been one of the first signatories to this movement. And why I say so, because I see this as a huge, huge opportunity for India when the education at the threshold of creating a globally competitive India. And this thought of the principle of responsible education certainly gel and also to make us not only competitive but also sustainable competitive. So great job done, ILM, and I must feel also equally delighted, because I also believe in this thought. The thought of creating these pillars of sustainable development right at the bottom of the beginning of education, when somebody looks at choosing a career and then thereafter moving ahead his professional life. If one gets that opportunity of making that change, I think perhaps you have done your bit to contribute towards what we call it global sustainable goals. To that extent, when Dr. Bhaskar Chatterjee asked me that we have this year initiated, in fact ILM has been year after year organizing this conference, so he brought one change, significant change, when he said, can we also create a contest among the organization or companies or individual who can bring some new insight and new practices. Conference like this has to only sustain when you bring something different and innovative, and this contest which was launched and brought a number of entries, and I must say that any efforts that you do for the first year, you get sometime not that much of response as much as you would have expected, but here it was very good response. And and when we as a jury member looked at all the entries, we found that the idea, I mean, I don't have to say what we went now. Actually, you have seen these two cases yourself. In the interest of time, each one of the case was so pioneering or also something different, and it was difficult for us at jury to choose which is the first one or second one. So then we decided that why not, in the interest of competitiveness or the recognition, look at both and give them an opportunity to showcase what they have to offer to all our participants sitting over here. So we went by all the papers, then we have a collective meeting here in the campus, and all four of us sat together, went by each and every aspect of the case, and today you see both of them coming over here. So my really heartiest congratulations for both the winners, that actually any efforts can get culminated when you have a solid research or findings or a new insight. To that extent, you did your own research, but how much of that has gone passed on to all the participants sitting here? Perhaps many of them would have got, there is a Goons or there is a Sandesh project, which success model that she has talked about. So that's the effort we must recognize. I must compliment Dr. Bhaskar Chatterjee for thinking this differentiation of bringing to the concept of having this conference year after year. It is certainly something that we should champion and bring it forward. As much as we will bring forward, it is good to our country and globally as well. So with these remarks, my best congratulations to the winners, and also as well as to each one of you who have assembled to listen to what it means that